Florida. Welcome to Believe. I'm Nicholas Upchurch. Our website is www.believe.love. Our YouTube is youtube.com/believeloves you. iTunes listeners, you can download our show at believeiTunes.com and on Android at believeandroid.com. It's an honor to be with you. And I am so excited because I want to help you to succeed and help you to find your truth and help you to believe in yourself. We have an amazing guest on our show today. Our guest is going to help to fill in some blanks of what is going on in terms of the movies and maybe some secret society stuff. And it's really exciting because our guest has such a prestigious background. He's really an amazing guy and he has so much knowledge. You ever wonder when you see a movie if you're actually seeing some things, you know, maybe even they're kind of slipping things in there. They're slipping in bits of truth. Actually, we went over this on a previous episode recently about the new Star Wars and the trailer. And we were asking, Natalia and I were on the show, and we were asking, man, I wonder if there's some truth in that. And then we pulled up the moon, I think, around Jupiter or Saturn that looks like the Death Star. And we're like, man, did George Lucas know something? So our guest today is going to help us to fill in some blanks because we want to help you to be aware of what's going on. If you're aware, you can have success in business, you can feel happier, you can get maybe a fuller, a bigger idea or a bigger picture in terms of why you're here. So I want to introduce in a second Robert W. Sullivan IV. And Rob is a philosopher, a historian. He's a lawyer, a mystic, a showman, a radio TV personality. You've heard him on Coast to Coast AM, on the great Sean Stone show, which is called Buzzsaw and Gaia. I love that show, actually. I watch that show a lot. He's been on Fade to Black with Jimmy Church. Love that show. And a variety of other, Veritas Radio. Love that. There's so many great places you've heard Rob on. He's the author of some really cool books. We're going to put those on screen now. And I recommend you check these out at Amazon. Specifically, as you can see here, the second edition of Cinema Symbolism, A Guide to Esoteric Imagery in Popular Movies. Also, The Royal Ark of Enoch. Arch, maybe? I don't know. I just got off a flight overnight from Vegas. I'm actually still waking up. We'll ask Rob in a second the proper title there, the proper pronunciation. I'm still like sleeping. I'm waking up. The Impact of Masonic Ritual. I know what that is, but Rob knows much more. The Impact of Masonic Ritual, Philosophy and Symbolism. The second edition is the one you need to pick up. And then Cinema Symbolism 2, More Esoteric Imagery in Popular Movies. I recommend you pick up all three. And Rob also he studied at Oxford. He was a Oxford University, of course, a prestigious university. He was a member of the Oxford University Conservative Association and the Oxford Law Society. He's got a lot of amazing knowledge. I want to welcome to the show Rob Sullivan. Welcome, Rob.
Hey, thanks for having me on your show tonight. Believe, it's my pleasure to be here, and I look forward to the show. And thank you for the invitation. Much appreciated.
Well, thanks for being on. So, Rob, I would love to know, really, I'd like to get inside of your head. What is the most sort of groundbreaking thing that you've noticed about what's in the movies?
Oh, I think generally, I think it's two-pronged. The answer would be is one is how that the material is actually in there, that this esoteric imagery is in the film. And it's one of those things that you don't have to really speculate on. You can watch the movie, and if you read the book, you'll be able to see it with your own eyes. So that's very interesting. It's not necessarily subject to speculation. You can actually see it. If you read the book or you've listened to some of my other shows and podcasts or radio shows, and certainly this one, you can actually find the material. You read the material and see it in the film. And the other thing that's very fascinating is the absolute lengths these filmmakers will go to incorporate this imagery in films. In some instances, it's quite astounding. And it almost brings up the question of, in some instances that they actually, were more preoccupied with incorporating this imagery than actually making the movie. It's very interesting. And like I said, it's a fascinating subject because you can actually read the book and then watch the movie and see it with your own eyes.
So in terms of your most recent book, as you're mentioning, Cinema Symbolism 2, which again, I recommend everybody pick up on Amazon. What would you say that some of the most recent sort of, okay, so first of all, if we're just gonna really simplify things, when you say esoteric symbolism, what should people be looking for? Because even if we're wanting to identify kind of what that means, can we talk about that? That'd be great.
Yeah, well, that's a real broad subject matter, and it really, there's no one answer for it. It depends on the film, because each film incorporates it or includes it in a different way. And I should also point out that some films don't include it at all. And not by not including it, it doesn't necessarily make it a poor movie. You can be dealing with a theme of a movie that is multi-layered, or is a story within a story, or it has esoteric underpinnings. You can be dealing with archetypal imagery. This can be embodied in the characters themselves. You could actually be dealing with symbols in the background of a film, dates, numbers. It can be dealing with archetypes. It can be dealing with storylines, the monomyth, the hero's journey. It can involve secret societies, ancient religions, Gnosticism, Kabbalah, alchemy. It's a sweeping subject matter, and no two films are alike. Each film that incorporates it can incorporate it, place it in a film in a different way. So I would say there's no like sweeping overall thing going on. Each film has to be looked at individually on a case-by-case basis to see if this imagery is even present. And if it is, what kind of film is it? Is it alchemical? Is it Kabbalistic? Is it archetype? Is it the monomyth? Once that can be discerned, then the interpretation, the symbolic interpretation then becomes much more clear, at least for me.
So we have some business, we kind of have a mix, people watching the show, people that are trying to grow their business, trying to get healthy. And we also cover our universe and world news. So if somebody's just not even aware of occultism or esoteric imagery, like those words, they're actually getting started with those words. Or even when you're talking about alchemy, could you give us some examples of kind of what that might be like in some specific films? And I've seen you've mentioned Stanley Kubrick's films and in your book, Cinema Symbolism 2. But maybe just simplify some of what these terms mean, if you don't mind.
Sure. Well, like the hero's journey, the monomyth, this comes out of the world of Joseph Campbell. And this is the hero's journey, the monomyth. And this is an adventure. The hero, usually personifying a solar archetype, goes on some, grandiose quest to overthrow evil in some form or fashion. And on this quest, certain interactions and things happen to this character that are universal. They repeat. So when we're dealing with films like this, we're dealing with the Harry Potter films. We're dealing with the Star Wars films, specifically 4, 5, and 6. We're dealing with movies such as The Lord of the Rings. We're dealing with the Matrix trilogy. These would be all films that incorporate the monomyth. Alchemy, of course, medieval and Renaissance alchemy is the transmutation of base metal into gold. Symbolically, this is ignorance into wisdom. In film, this usually involves transition of the self, where the person begins as one thing and ends as something else. And it's usually negative. These alchemical transitions are very seldom positive. So you think of something like Black Swan, where the movie begins as she's a timid ballerina, and then she actually, through a transition, morphs into an actual Black Swan creature. That would be an alchemical film. Same with The Shining by Kubrick. This is a movie where the guy starts as sort of a failed writer and morphs into a serial killer, a mass murderer. This would be characters who undergo an alchemical transition. An actual alchemical movie where you will actually see the transmutation of base metal into gold, or the transmutation of metal, would be Goldfinger by, the James Bond, where Goldfinger, the alchemist, is trying to transmute the gold in Fort Knox to make it worthless, to make his gold supply worth more money. So that is actual on-screen alchemy, quite literally. Wow. Then you have movies that involve Gnosticism, where it's a journey of enlightenment. Things that echo that theme would be, again, the Matrix movie, especially the first one. We would be dealing with something like The Wizard of Oz, Alice in Wonderland, the movie The Lovely Bones. It involves, the quest for self, to know thyself. This is another incredible, Gnosticism is incredibly popular ancient religion that is very popular in Hollywood. So yeah, it's a broad sweeping subject, and you know, no two films are really the same. It's each movie has to be looked at, and then it really what is key for me is to determine the film's context. When that is discovered, what I can determine its esoteric context, then the symbolism, at least for me, becomes much more readily apparent.
And what is your definition of esoteric? Because that's actually a really cool word, but I know a lot of people watching this aren't even really familiar with that word. And then, do you believe that there is truth disclosed in some of these movies with all of the symbolism?
Yes. Well, esoteric, what we're dealing with is mystical, hidden, occult symbolism that is used to convey ulterior or alternative, definitions of the movie, I guess is what I'm trying to say. You could watch a movie such as The Wizard of Oz. Let's take that. That's a great example. And you could just watch it on its face and say, okay, well, it's a journey of, it's just an adventure of this girl getting swept to this magical land and having this adventure. And then she goes home at the end, have a nice day. That movie is very multi-layered. You have themes going on of initiation into selfhood, initiation into gnosis, very, very interesting themes regarding ancient religion, Gnosticism. You have an entire political allegory going on inside The Wizard of Oz. So this is a very multi-layered movie. And when I say esoteric, it's hidden. It's not something that's going to jump off the screen at you. In some cases, it might. For me, it certainly does after I've been studying this for 20 years. But it's hidden in the celluloid. Is what I mean by when I use the word esoteric. And sure, there can absolutely be truths in it. There can be deeper meanings, deeper symbolism. We could be dealing with studies of comparative religion, archetypes that, the viewer may not be readily cognizant of, but through this imagery, it's really, harping on their subconscious mind, tweaking the archetypal imagery that we all have in our subconscious, really playing off of that. And it can be very powerful. And these filmmakers know very much what they're doing with it. I wouldn't go so far as to say it's a form of mind control or even so far as to say it's anything evil or anything like that. But it's definitely, when you're dealing with archetypal imagery, psychology, these themes, it's very powerful, and certainly movies are a very, very powerful tool, probably arguably the most powerful medium ever created. So this imagery is in there, and these filmmakers are using it, and it can be very potent. I think this is pretty irrefutable.
I agree with you. So I love your definitions, and I want to further explore them, because to clarify for people that are new to this, some other shows, Coast to Coast or Fade to Black, people may listen to that all the time and kind of know what archetypal means. But when you're like, when you say archetypal imagery, what would somebody be looking for in terms of what that might mean? And why is that important as well? Are they disclosing something? We've heard like the Illuminati has to, they feel that maybe they have to disclose things and shows and things like that to kind of get people's consent. But I guess there's a two-part question. The first is, what is archetypal imagery? Like, what's the definition of even an archetype? Some people may be new to that. And then also, like, are they trying to disclose things to kind of sort of get people's consent and sort of secretly let them know what they're doing in terms of maybe some sort of Illuminati or secret world organization or some of these secret societies?
Right. I'll answer the second question first. I don't believe in any of that at all.
Okay.
I don't buy into that. I think movies can be prophetic. Again, I would say in my books, I argue this is a mechanism of the collective unconscious. This is where the archetypes reside. Archetypal imagery, think the solar hero, the lunar heroine. You're dealing with a lot of astrological embodiments, planetary embodiments, Saturn, Jupiter, the Tarot. Archetypes of the hero, the villain, the mother, the father, the lovers. These are the archetypes. Luke Skywalker, Neo, Frodo. These are all These are all metaphoric stand-ins for the sun, the solar hero, the solar savior, the solar redeemer. The moon, the sacred feminine. These are the archetypes. I'm just giving you some examples, and they can vary, and they can take on, you know, different meanings, and they can take on different imagery. But the archetypes are very powerful, and you know, this is what, you know, Carl Jung talked about in his work, and even Joseph Campbell talked about. You know, when we talk about with Campbell, like the hero's journey, the book he wrote is called The Hero of a Thousand Faces, with a thousand faces. Well, who's the hero he's talking about? It's the sun. It's always the solar hero, the solar avatar, who's going on to deal with, to combat works of darkness. That's really the underlying theme with all this. You know, you can call it neo-Manichaeanism, I suppose. Light versus dark, good versus evil. I guess that's probably the oldest conflict of all. I mean, my goodness gracious, it's all over Hollywood films. I don't believe necessarily that there's some sort of secret global organization placing this stuff in films. That's pretty ridiculous, in my opinion. You know, I think some films are prophetic. I think some stuff is planted in there on purpose. I know that the government worked with the filmmakers of Transformers to put the railgun in, I think, the second Transformer movie. This was where they're announcing it, but this was no hidden secret. They came out and admitted this. Films can certainly be prophetic. I don't dispute that either. There are some very strange coincidences going on. And I say in the book, I don't believe in coincidences. As a lawyer, I don't buy into that. So, you know, how do you explain it? What I propose in my books is I get into the whole idea of Carl Jung and the collective unconscious and how this is inherited from generation to generation. And I suggest in the book that the collective unconscious, you know, unconsciousness may not necessarily only be inherited, but it may also be predictive. So what I conclude in the book is, and again, this is me speculating, this is not proven, is that, you know, when you get into a movie that may be prophetic, it could be the collective unconscious at work, actually working in reverse, since films are an artistic expression, ultimately, arguably one of the most powerful artistic expressions ever created. It would not surprise me at all that the collective unconscious could somehow integrate itself into a film as a prophetic mechanism. That's what I propose in the book, because clearly there are films that are prophetic, that I do not dispute.
So how do you know for sure that there's nothing hidden in films?
Oh, there is stuff hidden in films.
But I mean, do you think the president is in charge of the United States?
Well, I think he's in charge of it with Congress and the Supreme
Court. Who's in charge of the NSA?
Well, I would think this would fall. I mean, this is a political,
right.
You know.
But right. Okay. Do you think there are any organizations that are working in addition to the governments on policy in the world today?
Well, you have groups like Bilderberger and
right.
Certainly the Trilateral Commission and things like that. But I don't necessarily see them, you know, working toe in toe with, you know, with Hollywood or anything like that.
Well, but there, for example, like the CIA has a major, I think. What was it? The Rand Corporation has a major tie-in with Sony. I mean, there are emails going back and forth between the Rand Corporation and Sony in terms of directly discussing what will be in movies. Are you aware of that?
No, I'm not.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, I mean, I would definitely say that people should look into that. Rand Corporation, Sony, and Google emails. There are emails going back and forth. And it's kind of, for me at least, it definitely indicates involvement. You know, of course, we have things out in the open, like you said, regarding like Ben Affleck's movie. What would they went when they freed the people from Iran, right? The hostage movie. What was that?
Right.
You know, so that was more out in the open. But I don't know. I think that it's interesting. It's definitely an interesting topic. I'm not so sure that things aren't sort of worked in. But let me ask you about archetypes. Do you think that in addition to sort of the general archetypes that we're talking about, good and evil, the hero and the villain, you know, some people say, and I want to get your take on this because it's, you know, it's okay no matter what your take is. Of course, you know, we like to be open to a lot of ideas. But some people say that the archetypes could be other interdimensional beings and sort of on a global level, they may be influencing different world leaders. Some people say there could be specific beings that could be archetypes. Do you see any of that coming through in symbolism in cinema? Let me give you an example. Let's say there was a movie that had a certain storyline that tied in with a Hindu goddess. And for example, the guy who wrote the book on string theory that physicists use today was an Indian gentleman. And physicists use this book for string theory today, and he said he got all the information in his dreams from a Hindu goddess, which is, it's another discussion, right? But do you see any tie-ins with specific sort of religious archetypes or you know, Greek gods or different things like that?
Well, sure. I mean, I don't know. I guess, you know, again, you know, when you're dealing with archetypal imagery, you know, and you know, you, these can be the embodiment of, you know, of different gods and goddesses. Sure. I mean, you know, it can be pagan, it can be Christian, it can be Judaic. I mean, Jesus is, you know, the sun. I mean, he's a solar avatar, you know, and, you know, it, you know, even Moses is. So, you know, you can be dealing with archetypal imagery, absolutely, surrounding, you know, religious figures and religious, you know, this is, again, what Campbell talked about, you know, was his hero's journey was by and large archetypal, and, you know, was containing imagery and themes that were universal. So, you know, if you have it in, you know, in mythology, certainly you're going to have it in religion. So, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't necessarily disagree with that.
Oh, okay, good. Why is this important? Like, in terms of, because I think it is. I think it's very important. But you're an expert. You've been studying this for so long. What do you think the biggest reason why this is important would be to the average person?
Well, I mean, I guess, you know, it's you know, why are they doing it? I guess, is that what you're asking me?
Well, why is it something that we should be aware of? You know, symbolism in cinema, like you said, it's a very powerful medium. But studying it for so long, why do you think it's important for people to be aware of? Because really, it's something I think that's amazing you're paying attention to, but and it's definitely become quite important to you. But what do you think the significance of it might be to the average person to so they're aware of it? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I can't say what the significance is to the average person.
What do you think it should be? What's your inclination as to why it's important for you?
I think it's interesting. Because it really is, it's transforming it, what the filmmakers are doing. It's modern mythology making is why it's important. It's really creating, it's using motion pictures to create modern day mythology. That's why it's so interesting to me. And, you know, it's just so it's fascinating to see how these movies really can impact material culture, society, pop culture, and how they just become so integrated into our, you know, society. And it's powerful imagery, and that's what I found interesting. I compare it to sacred geometry or incorporating numbers into a building. You know, it's investing the building with a sense of divinity, and it's the same thing with this esoteric imagery. It's transforming the film celluloid into modern day mythology. That's really the best way I can answer it.
Sure, and I agree. I think it's important. I think it's amazing what they're doing as well. So you're saying it's basically because they're doing it and the scale, and it's just very interesting to you that it's happening. Is that kind of why it's important to you?
Well, it's interesting because, like I said, it's modern day mythology making. I mean, I was born in 1971. I grew up on Star Wars. I mean, and that's just become so integrated into our society. And it's really just speaks to the power of these archetypes and this esoteric imagery in the film. And I find that very interesting is, you know, that these movies, they contain this mythology, this imagery. Not all of them do, but a lot of them do. And it's just fascinating to me the lengths these directors will go to place it in to really, you know, make their movie into something more than just a movie. It's really modern day mythology making. And I like it also because I think in some instances it's a real challenge to these filmmakers. I think some of them really want you to pay attention and try to decode their films. And I think that's a fascinating challenge also.
I agree.